Just wanted to tell everybody in CS544/BioE196 that we are going to have the final game showcase, and that's going to feature games from this class as well as another class. So it's going to be a great event. I've already told 146 students about this, but I wanted to extend the invitation to you as well. You'll probably get an email at some point in the future. Also, all of our lectures are being recorded and posted online. This is our YouTube channel. You can join our legion of 5 subscribers. Just search Game Design at Stanford, CS146. You'll find us. And this is also a place a bunch of people have reached out regarding how they can hear about how the 146 projects are doing, because they're interested as 544 students. If you want to see our demo day, which we just did, you can go to our YouTube channel and you can see sort of the student presentations as an early stage prototypes before they work on their games and polish them for the final game showcase. Okay, brief announcements. We have no diamonds for the midterm to share with you today. The Niantic visit is being rescheduled to week 9. There will be a new sign up once the date is confirmed, so we'll get back to you on that. And I'd like to jump right into our case studies. So we are beginning a new unit this week regarding marketing. Okay, and marketing is all about getting our game to new users, getting it to new audiences. But before we can even start that discussion with respect to some audiences, we have to address what's called localization. Localization is a really important part of game development, and it's something that we don't dedicate an entire week to, so I wanted to dive deep on it within this case study. Localization, what does that mean? Well, in many cases, it's as simple as translation. Localization is just readying your game for a new audience. Normally, when we talk about localization, we're referring to EFIGS, that's EFIGS. This is sort of the minimum standard for releasing a game these days. What that means is we're going to plan to release our game in English, E, F, Italian, German, and Spanish. So basically, you want to hit all of those, and you can get a lot of people in the world. Notable exceptions to EFIGS are Chinese and Japanese, and the reason why the Western market is normally not targeted for sort of this minimum localization push is because if you want to address the Asian audience, it often does require more than just translation, and that's because the American game design, or let's say the UK game design paradigms don't necessarily transfer over, and so some different changes need to be made to the game rather than just translating it. And that's sort of where the difference between localization and translation begins. When it's essentially more than just translating it, that's where localization is involved. But sometimes it's as simple as translation, and other times games don't need to be localized at all. So I think when we think about the biggest hits in games, sort of these really popular little games like Flappy Bird or Crossy Road, I think one of the reasons why that's resonating with such a global audience is because it doesn't have a lot of text, and it's something that's pretty easy to pick up, even if you don't necessarily come from the same culture or you don't speak the same language. And I think that's a really wonderful game that that's a wonderful way that games kind of can connect us. Likewise, indies often overlook localization. It's probably the last thing on a lot of people's minds. So I wanted to share with you a brief case study of how one of my games was able to localize and reach new audiences. Marketing and the guerrilla marketing tactics we'll study on Thursday are really important to getting your game out there. That is how I got the first 100 or the first 1,000 downloads for my game. But speaking towards how I was able to get my game to its first 100,000 or first 1,000,000 downloads, that's really a matter of localization. And so we're going to speak to that. So when did I know I needed localization? Well, I started to get a lot of one-star reviews from Spanish-speaking countries. I think this guy summarized it pretty well. Nadrak says, if it's not in Spanish, it's crap. And that's translated actually from Spanish, so I'm sure he said something that was a little more spicy in the original description. But Google, you know, they sort of sanitize it when they translate it for you. But that's pretty awesome, because I get to see what they said, even if I don't speak their language. So that's a wonderful feature, and the point got across to me. These people want to play my game, but they can't understand it, right? They can't read it because it's in a different language. So, I was in the same shoes that you probably are in, which is that you don't have a crazy budget for this game, and you're trying to find creative ways in order to approach this localization problem. How am I going to get my hands into people around the world? So here was a strategy that I came up with. I created a fake email, essentially, called translatenostranger@gmail.com. And I told users, if you email this letter, we'll get back to you on ways that you can help out our game. And essentially, it was a vacation response email that would send them this text, essentially saying, hey, thanks for helping, and if you'd like to participate, you can jump into this editable spreadsheet, which was essentially an online Excel document, Google Sheets, if you're familiar with that. And what this allowed translators to do was people who were volunteers who had played the game and were also bilingually talented could go in and translate the game within a certain row or column. That way it could be approachable for new audiences. We faced a bunch of problems with this approach, so if it's something you're interested in, I'd love to talk to you about how I was able to overcome some of those smaller issues. But fine details aside, it suffices to say that we were a huge success. And now our numbers speak to that, so we have a wide variety of people. You'll see that Brazil is a big contender in our monthly downloads. Brazil, primarily those players are speaking Portuguese and Spanish. So this was a great success for my game at zero budget. We were able to sort of outsource the process and get a lot of new viewers and new audiences because of that. If I were to do this differently in the future, I think one thing that really anyone can do is try to automate the process. So maybe you don't have a successful game already, you don't have a number of volunteers who can help out, but if your game only has, I don't know, maybe 100 lines of text, it wouldn't be that difficult to put that through Google Translate and at least set yourself up with a very starter set of basically supporting eFix right out the gate. Of course, Google Translate isn't perfect, but it's better than nothing. And it would have really helped my translators if I presented them with sort of the Google Translate baseline and then asked them to verify that versus starting it. So those are just a number of strategies, which I would be happy to show you. Hopefully you enjoyed that. And do we have our presentation today? Speaker? All right, so she's a little bit late. Well, I'd be happy to answer questions that anybody has regarding localization and some of the challenges which you might face as a process of that. Yeah? That's a great question. So I think the way that we started our sort of guerrilla marketing campaign was through influencers. And this has become a really big part of marketing recently, especially as it pertains to video games. So what we have actually found, and I actually worked at this company who did this very interesting research study, is that an ad with an influencer is way more impactful, even if people aren't familiar with that influencer. Here's what the study involved. Basically, we knew that if PewDiePie played your game in front of his audience, and people saw he enjoyed it, people would know, hey, that's a fun game. But what we didn't realize was that if we dress somebody up, put on all this gamer gear, and put them in front of a video and said, like, hey guys, what's up? My name's Uber Joe, and we're playing this game today, kind of pretending like he's some sort of influencer, that actually had a huge impact. People didn't know the difference of PewDiePie versus Uber Joe or whatever, right? And so creating that kind of spoof influencer video was a huge impact in boosting our downloads, essentially. So that's not actually a method I employed on this particular game, but I found it's really successful and something you might want to try if you're thinking about ways to approach the marketing competition we have coming up. Speaking towards approaching new audiences, I am from the United States, so I often think about the US influencers, the English-speaking influencers, but often the PewDiePies of the world are way more targeted, saturated with all these requests for playing their game versus essentially who might be the best player for Spanish speakers. So I think reaching out to those Spanish speakers or other people who are maybe speaking to communities that are not the English community, that's probably the largest one, you can have a lot of great benefits from that because not as many people are looking at or chasing those audiences. But at the end of the day, if your game's accessible and easy to understand from someone who speaks any language, something like Crossy Road, something like Flappy Bird, you're going to have a way better time. And I think that's why games are increasingly moving towards this idea of trying to chase iconography. So something like a little hand that blinks on and off to show you have to click something is way more impactful than having text on the screen that says you have to click, because people understand the iconography and they don't have to get lost in the text. Yeah, any other questions? Yeah?
Did you have any way to prevent this trolls from the Google spreadsheet approach?
I actually didn't. This was a very Wild West approach, and I did sort of rely on the goodness of people. Thankfully, people were really excited to get involved. I think the biggest problem I faced with translations was everybody felt they knew their language a little better than the rest. So, for example, I left this alone for a while, came back a week later, and found there were 5 columns for Spanish. Apparently, Spanish is very different, whether it's from Mexico or Colombia or Spain, etc. And what a result of that was I had like 5 columns partially completed. So I was able to kind of aggregate those and said, hey folks, that's great if you want to do specialization for a territory, but let's just get Spanish done, even if it's a little motley, even if it doesn't make sense. That's a better place to start. So that's kind of the biggest problem I face in this approach. I think it would have been a lot easier if I had done a Google Translate method and kind of pre-populated those fields so people could verify versus typing it from the beginning. Yeah.
Why could it be harder to reach an Asian audience?
The reason why is because games designed for an Asian audience are sometimes a little different from a game design perspective. It is the case that some games are really popular across multiple cultures, but it's often the case that games of a certain genre may be very popular in other cultures. So for example, we've all heard of the term RPG, role-playing game. But perhaps you haven't heard of the term of JRPG, Japanese role-playing game. The reason why these are completely separate genres is because the way that players interact with them, the expectations of the players, they're all a little bit different. So those are kind of some of the things you might want to consider if you're trying to approach an Asian audience. You might need to approach the game from a different design perspective than you would an English-speaking audience. Does that answer your question? Okay, right on. Is there any other questions regarding localization or regarding the class? Introduce our speaker now. Thank you.
Just need to see the laptop.
Sure.
Sorry,
we'll help you out.
This or HDMI. There's nothing on the answer.
You guys, I'll just do a quick one. So today is all about publishing. We have Shannon Loftus, who's the general manager at Microsoft Studios First Party Publishing. She's worked on over 40 games in her career, from games such as Fable and Gotham Racing to the solitaire game that comes pre-installed on Windows. And we also have Will McMahill, McHill. And he works with her. He's a senior business manager at Microsoft.
Hey, everybody. So how many of you are gamers? A lot of people, great. How many of you have actually created a game? Okay. And how many have published a game? Cool. Alright. I think we came to the right place. We'll skip the whole bio thing, but the one thing I do want to say is when you've been in games for as long as I have, 23 years, you develop some bad habits. They include things like tendency to dress like Doctor Who, to regard every encounter as a boss fight, and being extremely critical of the way the sky looks when we're flying into California because there's too many particles. And everywhere that I go, I'm required to bring with me some adult supervision. So Will is the adult supervision today. I'm the general manager for Microsoft Studios Publishing. I've been in games for 23 years, and I've done basically everything from engineering to design to studio foundation. And now I run a portfolio of games that includes, as was mentioned, the casual suite. And Will, do you want to talk about yourself?
Shannon's my boss's boss, so I'm going to try not to say anything that, you know, is around.
here.
He's here to keep me from making potty jokes.
Yeah. I did work in XBLA, which was the Xbox Live Arcade thing back in the day. That was one of the first jobs that I had at Microsoft, doing portfolio analytics, background in data science, and now I'm a business manager working on the Age of Empires franchise, Killer Instinct, State of Decay, I don't know if you guys have heard any of those games, and a few other ones that I'm not allowed to talk about. But yeah, I've been in games for 5 years now at this point, and it's really fun.
So there's a good reason that I brought Will, because this is one of the things I want to do before we dive into the meat of publishing is to establish some common knowledge about the state of the industry, where the cash flows, where the and what the kind of current business trends are. And Will is basically a human numbers machine, so he's going to dive in as we go through some of the current, what we call industry profit pools. So this year, gaming was a $100 billion industry globally. And that's up from $90 billion last year and $75 billion the year before. The expectation is that this industry will grow to become a $200 billion industry total within just 2-3 years. Most of that growth is projected to come from, mobile is still growing, although it is slowing down, but there are some new categories of revenue that are emerging. Video is one that's everything from YouTube to Twitch to, does everybody here know what Twitch is? Yeah? Okay, cool. To Mixer, Microsoft's own streaming service. And a couple of additional new categories that are emerging that we'll talk a little bit about. Stay back here. Get standing behind the podium. So the rest of this, I'll just skip over this slide, basically. The vast majority of that $200 billion is actually coming from the software and services side rather than the hardware side. Obviously, doesn't include the sale of mobile devices, but really quick, so we'll just talk about the software and services side. So mobile is the largest from 2017, with $59 billion globally in income. The vast majority of that is games that are made in China. So remember, this is 17, and it doesn't include Fortnite, and it doesn't include PUBG, some of the largest games to hit mobile in the last 12 months. But the interesting thing is, of that $59 billion, fully 10% of it is owned not by one company, but by one studio out of China. A studio that's called Studio Tumi, and they make a game called Arena of Valor, or in the West it's called Honor of Kings, or maybe it's the other way around. Do you remember?
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. The remaining segments, PC, console, social, and video, are small in comparison when you include China. When you exclude China, the mobile market shrinks quite a bit. This is, you know, it's the Chinese market lends itself to mobile gaming for a lot of different reasons, some of which is governmental specific. But the main point I want you to take away from this slide is that I know that many of you are considering publishing and are working on mobile games, and they're great, and they're still incredibly viable. But other platforms are viable as well. PC is a growing market. Console is growing, but it's growing a little bit more slowly. The one I would recommend everybody stay away from are the social kind of Facebook and web-based games. Is this interesting? It's mobile. No, we already talked about this.
Everything's growing,
but
social.
Okay, and then just worth noting that the big takeaway here is that it used to be that free-to-play games were the exclusive province of social and mobile, but that free-to-play model is starting to permeate every aspect of the game market. And I can tell you that if we had this chart that was current for this year, there'd be a much bigger green chunk on console as well because of Fortnite and because of PUBG and because of a couple of other games that have made a huge swing in the market this year. So free-to-play is definitely the dominant. The benefits of free-to-play are that there's a totally low barrier to entry. Anybody guess what the downside of free-to-play is? Pretty obvious. Most people are in this games thing to make money. It's a money-making scheme. So you got to have a way to have revenue on the back end. And it turns out that getting that revenue on the back end of a mobile is totally non-trivial. So the next couple slides dive into the mobile market itself a little bit more deeply. So we can skip that. something to keep in mind about the mobile market is that it's astoundingly crowded and it's incredibly dynamic. Just from the perspective of the number of games that get released on an annual basis. The numbers are up here. 340,000 new games were released to Google Play in 2007. 340,000. It's incredibly difficult to make your game stand out in a crowd that big. There are ways to do it, and we'll talk about it, but it is not a trivial thing. And I guess if you take one thing away from tonight, it's that writing the game is less than half the work of making a game and getting it into the marketplace. The rest of it is talking to your users, finding ways to remain relevant, sustaining engagement. Even if it's a one-time play and drop, you have to do all of these things, and we'll talk a little bit about that work. How many of you have heard the term user acquisition? Some, okay. So there is actually a segment, a sub-segment of the industry that where a company, a game company, Microsoft, for instance, we do this with Casual Suite. We will pay an advertising company to advertise our games in other games. That's called user acquisition. So basically, if you're playing something on your phone and we think you're a good match for this, our solitaire suite, which is by far like the best solitaire suite you're ever going to find. we'll pop up an ad, and if you click through, you're obtained. It costs a certain amount of money to obtain a user that way, and then my goal, my job, once I've obtained that user, is to make more money from them than I paid, and then that's a positive transaction. So different users cost different amounts of money. Casual Suite is actually a fairly inexpensive user. They're what, like?
$2.80
to acquire a Casual Suite user. And we make about $3.50. And we're making that money through in-game purchases and through advertisements. The interesting trend right now with user acquisition is that as the mobile market slows and as the game market becomes saturated, it gets harder and harder to make positive revenue on acquired users. They become more expensive. And so most companies at this point are moving to a combination of UA and game cross-referencing, game cross-promotion. So that means that it's more beneficial to you as a game developer to put two games into a mobile marketplace and combine user acquisition with ads that promote the other game. So we have Casual Suite and we have Mahjong. Our Casual Suite game has Mahjong ads that are click-throughs straight to the game, and our Mahjong game has Casual Suite ads that are click-through, or Casual Solitaire ads that are straight through to Solitaire. And that in that way, we're getting and we're retaining users across two different gaming ecosystems and making more money on them.
So we can talk a little bit about just how we calculate the value of what that user is. So every single user that we look at, when they come into a game, we measure that specific user. Where did they come from? What did we pay for these particular users? With some sort of SDK from whatever we've, or from Google or from Facebook or whatever. We look at their ARPDAU, which is their average revenue per daily active user. So that's how much revenue do we get from these people per day. We then multiply that by their retention curve. So we say, oh, if this user is going to pay, or is going to play the game 43 days. Multiply that by however much money we're making off of them per day, and then that's the value that we see in that user long term. We normally have some sort of horizon window, like we want to have our money back by 365 days. We are less and less able to do that over time because a lot of our competitors are just going in and buying as many people as they can, because it turns out that even more valuable than buying users for user acquisition is being in that top app, top most downloaded app page up on the front of Google Play or whatever. So those big players are able to buy tons of users at a loss just so they can drive in a whole bunch of extra organic users that come in at the same time. So it's very difficult to actually break in and get onto that front page unless you have either a absolutely incredible game that like you manage to beat all the other mobile apps that have a whole bunch of data scientists behind it, or if you have a ton of money, you can buy your way up there.
When you make a game and you put your kind of heart and soul into the creative vision of the game, and you spend a lot of time and a lot of care trying to craft a gamer experience, whether you've made a skill-based game or a story-based game or an art game, there's a ton of gamesmanship that also goes into keeping your game afloat in an incredibly loud and crowded and competitive mobile marketplace. When you look at a company like a Supercell or King, they have armies of data scientists that are constantly working, doing A/B tests, running deep experiments. I recently made a visit to Tencent in China, and I got to meet the lead data scientist for League of Legends in China. League of Legends is primarily a mobile game in China. And of course, China has very different privacy laws, and it was a super fascinating experience because she came in and she's like the sunniest person that I've ever met. She's so excited, she speaks great English, and she's like, you know, she throws her arms around me in a big hug when she first meets me, and it was, you know, we had a really nice kind of social chat, and then she sat down and she started showing us. And Tencent, in case you don't know, they are the biggest gaming company in the world, and they own, among other things, they own WeChat. And WeChat is a social network, and it is also a payment network in China. So, and it's a marketplace. So she starts talking about how with WeChat, we know who you're friends with, we know when you're awake, we know when you're thinking, when you're shopping, when you're buying, who you're playing with, what you're playing, what you're considering, where you go, because geo is always on. And because, again, you know, the Chinese government does not limit access to data or methods of combining data. They literally have like this incredibly robust profile on every single player. And she's talking about this silver skin experiment that they ran in League. And I don't remember exactly what there's some item that they wanted to test the market value of, and it was a silver version of a pretty common item. And they looked for people who had shopped for silver things, whether they were game items or, you know, like purses or whatever. And then they cross-referenced that with the number of people that are playing League. And then they threw the silver item into a random fight, like put it in a loot box to see who was going to shop for the game after having the exposure in a battle, or shop for the silver item. And then she talked about how their initial tests were that people had their price sensitivity for the silver item was like $1.35. But the longer they kept it out of reach in a loot box, or just out of reach on an opposing team, or made it a little bit rarer, they managed to drive the average price up to like $2.89. And I'm sitting there looking at her, realizing that I'm staring into the maw of pure evil. I have a son who plays League of Legends, and he spent an entire week working on chores so he could buy a couple of loot boxes trying to get a silver item, and he didn't get it. And so it was an interesting just window into the data-driven A/B experimentation mentality that helps to float some of the most successful games in the world to the level where they are. And it's a way of life. The guys that run the casual suite, the solitaire game, they also have Ultimate Word Game, Mahjong, Jigsaw, Minesweeper. These are not games that you would consider to be heavy hitters, but they are by far the most profitable games that Microsoft has. So, Will, do you want to talk about this?
Yeah. Has anybody here published games on itch.io? All right, you two know probably more about it than I do then, which is great. A big part of my job is looking at different platforms, trying to figure out if we're going to make money if we release on a certain platform. Should we bring this game to Steam? Should we keep it as an Xbox exclusive? What is that going to cost us? Can we drive like some strategic initiative like Game Pass or something like that? So looking at platforms like itch.io is definitely something that I do pretty frequently, but I'm very much heavily on the business side more than the publishing side of it. So itch.io, there's a lot of games there. But if you look at the actual users that are playing games on itch.io, you shouldn't really expect to make a lot of money. The people who are there are very interested in game development and releasing games and everything, but the machines that they're playing on are generally much lower quality machines. You might have a Chromebook or something like that. Like, most of those users are going to be on an itch.io. Low-powered machines, which unfortunately means lower quality spend, lower ARPU, which is our average revenue per user. Like, all those stats go way, way down when you don't have a discrete graphics card or something like that. So it's, I mean, it's a very admirable setup, the way they have it. Like, it's great for publishing your first game. They've got a cool model where they let you pay kind of whatever you think is fair. It doesn't look like a lot of people are buying there. The top-selling games that are also available on Steam for the most part. And in this Game Maker survey that we looked at, very few people, 1%, said that they would actually consider buying games from it. And they've, like, if you look at the traffic that actually is driven into itch.io, most people are searching, I think 33% of people were searching for browser free games when they actually made their way to itch.io. It's an interesting platform. I wouldn't go there if you're planning on trying to make a lot of money. I would try to go to some other Steam place. You're still going to be drowned out in an ocean of 100,000 games if you go here, but it's probably a really great way to get your foot in the door and just understand what game publishing is like. All right. Next is Steam. So Steam is interesting for us because we obviously have a competitor, which is our Windows Store.
Not very successful.
So Steam obviously is the big place right now. And more than the 291 million players that they have and the fast growth and amazing growth that they have in China, they have most of the people who have really great machines. So like Intel targets their 230 million people who are like the top 20% of PC gamers who are after, who will build their own machine or buy a really high-end gaming rig. Steam has a disproportionate number of these people. 73% of people who have a GPU that can do 1 teraflop or faster are on Steam, or we're seeing them on Steam in our Windows 10 telemetry. So if you look at where a lot of the money is spent, because they have these high-value users, they're able to do way better in terms of game sales because these people have their libraries there. They're going to stick around there for a really long time because it's convenient. And basically, Steam has most of the games that are going to be on the platform anyways. I don't remember if there's anything else that we wanted to call out about Steam specifically. I mean, best gaming machines are there.
Steam's,
there's tons of games, though.
Yeah, one of the things that Steam is really good about is they have the capability to merchandise games. Merchandising meaning put a game on a front page and cross-reference games or cross-recommend games to people. If you're playing this, you can play, you might like that. It's extremely rare for Steam to take an action like that with some of the Steam Direct. Sorry, what's the new name for the Steam Direct program? Steam does have a non-published, a self-published section, and they rarely promote those games, but they will promote if you hit a certain number of downloads or if you hit a certain number of wish lists. And so
yeah.
I mean, that's the other thing is a lot of the other, and we'll go through some of the self-publishing platforms as well with you, but these are two examples of places where you can put your own games out and what kind of gamers. The difference between an itch.io and a Steam is that with Steam you can find the heavy hitter, you can find the easily monetized, wealthy gamers, but they have a much higher expectation for what the game quality is going to be like. Itch.io is more of a casual gamer site. It's a
similar to a Facebook game room, and actually, honestly, the Windows Store. We have a lot of casual games in the Windows Store. We've grabbed a lot of those more casual consumers. All of these different platforms, with maybe the exception of the Battle.net launcher, have really struggled to grab that real core audience that spends a lot of money. I think the other thing to call out on Steam, actually, is just how quickly they discount products. On average, within 6 months of being on Steam, your game is expected to be at a 50% off point. The median is 50% at 6 months, and then at a year you're supposed to hit 75% off. So it is really like done a good job of basically getting a whole bunch of bargain barrel games that like you've got these really high quality products, but they're 6 months old, and Steam has so much content coming in that if you really want to be able to cut through the noise and trick their algorithm into putting you up on the front page, you need to go really aggressive with your discounts. If you compare that to like an Xbox, you're looking at 50% off after about a year. Anything else? Okay. So talking about a couple of indie breakouts. So I guess I kind of missed it before. So it's very, 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 very difficult to break out without some sort of like amazing act of God type thing behind you. So like Minecraft is a great example.
True. There are things we can, and we'll talk about things you can do to try to rise above the noise level.
Yeah, so in the XBLA days, we looked at a lot of different products, right? And these are curated products where we had industry veterans coming in and picking out the games that they thought were going to be the best. And generally speaking, about 1 in 10 of those were a success financially. Like, they did really well and made their money back and everything else. And about 1 in 100 of those were some amazing thing. Minecraft came out of that. That was obviously the big winner that we had. But there were other games that also did very, very well, just not at the level of commercial success that you're going to see for a Red Dead Redemption 2 or something like that. So when we talk about indie breakouts, like, these are games that have done really well, but maybe they're playing to a more niche audience because that was what the indie creator wanted. And there's a lot of different ways to define what is, like, success. But specifically for these titles, like, I mean, I've personally have played Undertale. It's a great game, but it plays to a pretty niche audience. There's a lot of people who are really into it, but it's never going to have this critical success of $750 million in its first weekend.
But no games do. I mean, the one thing these games do have in common is that when their creators put them into the marketplace, they did a few basic things to try to make sure that they didn't sink beneath the waves, and we'll talk about what those things are.
Yeah.
Have you guys played, has anyone here played like Monument Valley? I thought that was an incredible game. And the interesting thing is, the people that made that, they're not even game developers. They're literally like software infrastructure creators. And they just had a few people that did a weekend and evening project that became Monument Valley. And then they were super, super smart about merchandising in the iOS store. So we'll talk a little bit about that.
Yep.
So those are all effectively self-published games, and they are, so one of the things we'll talk about in just a minute is the difference between self-publishing and working with a publisher, and there's actually a spectrum of publishers that you can work with. Each one of these games started out, they didn't all end up that way, but they all started out as self-published and rose to a level where they were recognized as hits, and then either got publishing deals or they moved on their own. But at a higher level. Can anybody else in here tell me another super popular self-published game?
Yeah. Stardew Valley?
Yep. Stardew Valley is a great one.
Yeah.
Does anyone else have any other examples? There's one, it's the biggest game in the world right now. And it's not Fortnite. Yeah. Minecraft was self-published until Microsoft. We started publishing it on Xbox, and then it moved, and then we acquired it. League of Legends. League of Legends is still a self-published game. It is owned by Tencent, but Riot actually makes all the decisions and all the promotion, and they basically, that game started out as a mod and hit incredible levels of success. So,
yep.
All right, so that was sort of like business foundation, and I know it's a lot of numbers and statistics. Rest assured, Will and I are gamers, and we're game creators at heart, and we both work in a publishing organization. Will has not yet worked in a studio. I've worked in several studios, and I've started a couple of studios, and like, if you don't approach the business side and the publishing side with the same heart and passion that you bring to the game creation, then you're losing an opportunity to make a lasting connection with your customer. It's going to make you a better game developer. So publishing at its heart is just getting shit out to people. Making sure that gamers know that your game is there and getting them to play it, getting just making the connection directly with the customer. This is a very dry, this is my my broken build slide. Sorry, I meant to fix that on the plane and didn't. But video game publishing is the rest of the work that you do after you create the game. So first of all, the money doesn't stop flowing once you finish making a game. Typically, you'll need money to fix bugs that arise when you release your game into the marketplace. You might need money to continue to make content for your game if that's the kind of game that it is. You might need money to take your game to new markets if you decide, or to new platforms. Maybe you release initially on itch, you get a really good response in terms of downloads, and you decide to make a go of Google Play, but there is code associated with getting a game onto Google Play. And so funding is one of the things that is important for video game publishing. Marketing. Does anybody, I mean, this is a super obvious question. shout out what you think marketing is. Because we argue about this all the time. Advertising's part of it, yeah.
Advertising?
Right, exactly. Trying to figure out what you need to say to a customer about the game itself. Yeah.
Just getting engagement from the audience.
Yeah, engagement, exactly. Marketing is changing, and part of it is demand generation. It's creating all the visual identity and everything so that people will recognize your game when it's in the market. Everything from the thumbnail to the name, making sure that the name isn't something that's already used, to figuring out what the right price is for your game, figuring out what are the right markets for your game. And that's all kind of classic marketing. And nowadays, marketing also includes making contact with influencers and streaming the game and building community around the game, and then managing that community, actively managing the community. How many people here know what community management is? Just a couple. Okay, has anyone ever been out on a forum for a game specifically and seen a comment get taken down? That's a negative side of community management. But community managers are the people who are responsible for saying, hey, we've got an update coming, or hey, we've got, you know, there's a tournament coming up this weekend, or we're going to have a special stream with somebody famous, or, you know, hey, I'm the developer of the game, and I'm going to go out and do an AMA on Reddit or something like that. So that aspect of community management is absolutely critical for games these days. It's actually far more important and far more effective than television advertising, believe it or not.
They actually do more than that, too, just for the developer side. So our community managers keep their pulse on what audiences are asking for and looking for in the products, and they're communicating that actively back to the developers so we know, hey, like we're super heads down in this, we're in Microsoft land, but we have one person who's in community who's out there like in all the forums saying, hey, these are the things that I'm seeing people complain about, these are the things that we need to go fix. That is also a hugely critical component because it helps us prioritize what bugs we need to go fix next and what features we need to add.
Right. Another thing that community management might do is create meetups. So real world engagement is a huge part of community management as well, and possibly the most frightening. Okay, so distribution. Where are you going to ship your game? What marketplaces are you going to put it in? What does it take to get into that marketplace? What does it take to stand out in that marketplace? What countries are you going to be in? Are you going to have, and this is increasingly untrue for games, are you going to have a physical aspect to your game? Are you going to have a CD in an Amray case somewhere? I don't know if we're allowed to say this, but I'm going to say it anyway. Like Forza Horizon 4 is our huge holiday release from Turn 10 Studios for Xbox and PC. And their digital distribution this year was well over half. And that is a game that has its roots, its tradition, is in physical media. So the fact that people are now opting more and more for game downloads, even for things that used to be, you know, collector's editions and stuff like that, is a huge trend that I predict that in not so very long there will no longer be physical media. But until then, how are you going to get your physical media done? There are companies that will print your game and distribute it for you if you're self-publishing. Operating. This is the person that's carrying the beeper for when your servers go down. Also the people who are checking out the BI, the data that's coming in from gameplay, from real-life play situations. And then helping you to make decisions based on that telemetry with what you're going to do with your game. Sound design is something that most people consider to be part of gameplay, but really good sound design is really expensive, and a lot of the time the publisher will pay for it. And it's especially necessary if you want to have licensed music, because licensing music as an individual game designer or game developer is, I will tell you, it is not possible. You cannot do it. It has to go through somebody who has a lot of lawyers. Licensing and merchandising, t-shirts, plushies, baseball hats, pins, lanyards. Gamers love this stuff. They eat it up. Has anybody here ever been to a PAX? Yeah? shopping is like, it's nerd heaven. I go broke every year. Geek, was it Geek? Not GeekWire. Anyway, there's a game merchandising company that does super. I don't even know what I'm thinking of. Yeah, thank you. They do super high quality nerd merchandise, and it's all legit licenses, and so. That stuff is huge, and it can really help you to build your community and build the momentum and appreciation. PR, telling people, talking to the press, and letting journalists know when your games are coming. This is another hot topic at Microsoft because, personally, does anybody here know what Metacritic is? A lot of people. So Metacritic is a review number aggregation site for every game. It's very much like Rotten Tomatoes for movies. It aggregates critical reviews into a single score, and it used to be that there was a direct correlation between your Metacritic and your ability to sell in certain marketplaces. And over time, we're seeing that correlation degrade. I still appreciate a very well-written critique for a game, but I think it's far more important for you to PR to game influencers. It's practically impossible at this point to get in touch with some of the top streamers. But, you know, if you hit those mid-tier streamers and get them playing your game, sending them free codes and stuff like that, it can have a tremendous impact on your sales momentum. Community we already talked about, localizing. What if you decide you want to ship your game in, China's difficult, but you want to ship it in France. Maybe you believe that there's a particular cultural appeal in France or Germany. Understanding the laws of those companies and our countries, and then also understanding how to make your game linguistically relevant, whether it's an on-screen translation or the removal of language or whatever. And then finally, just support. People that can't make your game run, who's going to answer the questions on the forums? And these are all publishing functions, and they're equally important to actually finishing the game. They sound like a lot of work, but the vast majority of these involve talking to people who want to play your game. And there is nothing better. It's gamers are the craziest, most passionate, most demanding, most entitled, creative group of consumers that you can ever hope to engage with. And I sincerely hope that everybody here gets to. Okay, so two ways to publish. We've been talking about this a little bit. You can self-publish, or you can work with a publisher. Probably clear to you by now that with the volume of games that are out there, it's incredibly, there aren't that many publishers, and it can be very, very difficult to work with a publisher. But just to kind of lay a little bit of groundwork about what the difference is, if you are working with a publisher versus this is a self-published, you basically have to do all of the tasks that I just mentioned, but you can count on distribution for the platforms that you're publishing through. So itch.io handles your distribution. Kongregate handles your distribution. Google Play, that means people go, you know, when they find your game, you can count on them to get the bits to the devices. And that's actually even more complicated than it should be even today. But everything else is on you. And the question to ask yourself is, how am I going to handle these things? Not every game will need everything. You might not need specialized sound design. You might not need a German language version of your game. But I guarantee you that every game will thrive a lot more if you actively engage with your community, if you engage with game players, and you keep active in the community and keep your game relevant. So there are many, many, many different levels of publishing. Some publishers will just engage, like there's a company called THQ Nordic, and THQ Nordic do no funding of game development for the most part, but they're really great worldwide global distributors. And so they'll do a bunch of the work for you in terms of marketing in local markets that you have no way to reach, doing PR, talking to journalists and press there. But you're still responsible for the entire game, you're responsible responsible for support and the rest of the community work. And then a full-on first-party, AAA, luxurious, publishing deal, AAA, and this is kind of what Will and I do on a daily basis. And we work with developers of all sizes, Microsoft in particular, every platform holder. Sony will do this, Nintendo does it, Microsoft does it. We all have self-publishing options on our platforms. We have what's called something at Microsoft, it's called an ID at Xbox program, which is where you get a chunk of these support services, not necessarily all of them, but you are responsible for the funding of your game. And then all of it, there's a second party option, which is typically marketing plus distribution, localization, and a little bit of money to help get the game done. And then first party publishing is full partnership, where your game is fully funded. You may be supported with everything from technical artists to narrative designers, world builders, engineers, and operations. And then we will also help you build up whatever server infrastructure you need in our in Azure. Am I missing anything from you as well?
No, you didn't have business management as a function before, but I got over it.
We also, well, actually, this is a really good point. As an independent developer, say you're at stage 3, you put your game into itch, it got a lot of attention, maybe from some gamers that you would not expect to find on itch. You move it to Steam, it's gaining momentum, you've had some successful streams with some influential streamers, you've had a lot of activity maybe on Reddit or something like that. If you're interested in taking the next step and getting a publisher, does anybody know, I'm not even gonna ask this as a question, this is like it shocks me every day. Agents. Agents never used to be relevant in the gaming industry until the last 5 years, but with the rise of the democratization of game development tools and the rise of as many self-publishing options as we have these days, engaging with an agent can be incredibly beneficial. They, for the most part, will act as the business management function for an independent developer. So they will help you figure out, if you decide you want this to be your job, they will help you figure out your cash flow and how many people you can hire and when you can hire, and they will make contact with publishers for you and negotiate your deal. Agents are rarer than publishers, and so, but if you're going to engage with a publisher ever, if you're ever going to get to that first, that second party or first party, or even the ID level, you're going to want to be working with an agent. And all the same people that do Hollywood agency representation also do games representation, so CAA and
UTA.
And then there are a couple of additional, like there's a DDM, there are a couple of additional specialist agencies, but you make contact with them the same way that you make contact with a publisher, which is go show your game off at an Indiecade, go show your game off at a PAX independent game festival. Game Development Conference has a game indie game festival, and the agents are constantly patrolling there looking for new customers, new clients.
If you guys get like 100,000 downloads, don't go contact an agent, just come to me directly. And I would much rather negotiate with you than a professional agent.
Didn't I hear somebody in here had 1 million downloads? No? I thought that was one of the emails.
Yeah, we have 2 TAs and 1 million.
That's awesome. What kind of games? So these are a few of the self-publishing options, self-publishing the marketplaces where you can put your games. This has been a really boring presentation in terms of just a whole bunch of bullet points on a slide. And I'm not going to insult your intelligence by running through the terms and everything for each one of these options. You can look any one of these up on Wikipedia and get the terms that you want. I mean, learn what their terms are. For the most part, it's a 10% to the distributor, and then negotiate. You can give them more if you want to. I'm never really clear what the circumstances are where you would want to do that. But the bigger ones like Steam and Google Play and Apple Store are going to take 30% of your revenue. Xbox Creator Program, I don't actually know what our terms are.
I think it's 30 as well.
I don't think so. I think it's 15 or 20.
We've had it at 20 in the past.
Yeah. So there are new self-published publishing options every day. And when you're deciding which one you want to go to, think about what you want to get out of your first publish for your game. You'll probably hear this from somebody other than me. Game ideas are not that common. Like, to come up with a great idea for a game, that's really special. But what matters is the execution on it. And it's much smarter to test your game in the marketplace, get feedback, and then take the next step and republish it than it is to deep dive and hold on to your game idea for a long time. It's actually, there aren't that many people in the world that are going to go through the trouble to take an idea and turn it into a working piece of software, which has all the bells and whistles and parts necessary for gamers to actually get their hands on and play. So don't be afraid to test your ideas out on some of the smaller marketplaces like Game Jolt or something like that before you go to a Google Play. And then when you go to Google Play, just know you're in a really, really, really big pond, and you're going to have to do a few things to make your game stand out. Okay, so I was told that we should build a little Q&A in the middle. That was the highly academic and numbers-based part of this talk tonight. So, there's a little more numbers, though, because of Will. Subscription dollars, and then a lot of the services like Twitch, Mixer, will also, and YouTube Live will also have an ability to pay streamers, like you can give them gifts and stuff like that.
Okay.
Yeah.
So if it's, our most free games have some sort of microtransaction thing that goes into it. So if you're publishing it fully free, I don't know how many games are out there that are fully free. I think almost all of them have some sort of ad-based monetization scheme or something else like that.
But there are a lot of them will collect a platform fee, and it's something like, it's generally pretty low, like I think $30 for itch. I think GOG is like $75 or $80. But if you're not charging for your game, then obviously there's no revenue to share.
For the platform holder, it's great to have free games. It's just driving, just have more content for people to come in. If you drive up your concurrency, those people are bound to spend money on other things.
Right.
So they have an incentive to keep it low.
Yeah.
Can you talk about the difference between publishing and VC funding?
I'm not 100% sure on this, but I think VC funding for game development is extraordinarily rare. I think VC funding for game startup is different. And then when you have, I will call it a fad, VR, I have faith in the future of VR, but I do think that the funding game peaked really early for VR, long before it was going to be mass commercially available. The difference is that, you give up part ownership in your company for VC funding, and with publishing, you give up part ownership of the future revenue, but not necessarily ownership of your company. Yeah.
Are there any ways to get in contact?
This is a good question. I think, I get that the conferences are tough because not everybody can afford to travel, but it is, like, hands-on is the best way. Publishers, we get submissions it's hard to rise above the noise level, I think. Having something that's playable and something that you can point to some results on one of the self-publishing platforms will increase your chances of getting attention from a publisher. So if you can say, I put this out and I have 50,000 downloads, that every single one of those people monetized it to some degree, that would be, that would definitely get the attention of a publisher.
Better knowing somebody.
Well, that's...
Recruiting somebody who is going to be able to make a connection for you.
Yeah.
Capacity.
It's difficult. I mean, definitely right now, the best bet is to go to one of the shows, and there are lots of them. There's Casual Connect, and there are dozens of those. The Indiecades, the here close to home in the spring is the Game Developer Conference. Yeah, I mean, it is challenging to rise above the noise. Okay, we should probably dive back in. Yeah, I'm actually only going to talk about one of these slides, and then we'll go to the trends because I think that's more important. This is super important. You've made your game. You've poured your heart and soul into it. It's the story of your childhood. It includes a lot of psychology, a lot of art. You stayed up all night getting the particle effects just right. But you need to be able to take a step back, be objective about your game. What do you want from this game when you put it into the marketplace? Are you putting it in to make a lot of money? Are you putting it in to get attention as a game developer? Are you putting it into the marketplace to test your ideas and to test the waters and consumer reception to your game? Yet the important thing here is to give yourself capacity to be meta about the purpose of giving your game out to people. So there are a few things to keep in mind. Number one, is your game in a genre that's already crowded? I can tell you right now that Battle Royale is really crowded right now. I don't think I've seen a pitch in the last year that didn't have a Battle Royale mode. I think the other thing is, what is the size of a genre? I think platformers are one of the most common. Does everybody here know what Battle Royale is, by the way? The one versus, it's 100 people and then the last one standing. And then does everyone know what platformer is? What's your favorite platformer?
Mario.
Mario, yes, exactly. With the exception of Mario, platformers actually don't do well these days. Like, they are extremely limited with respect to, but the funny thing is, it's the first place that a lot of indie game development goes. And I think it's great, because I think you can play with mechanics and learn about storytelling through gameplay mechanics and visuals. But it is something that it's very uncommon for a platformer game to break out and just know it's incredibly crowded. Story-based games, text-based story games actually are making a huge comeback right now. And that's a great, it's a great opportunity, I think, for startup game development, particularly if you have super compelling writing.
So platformer specifically, about 5% of the audience will be interested in a platformer. If you look at an action-adventure shooter, you're going to get 25 to 50% of the audience that could potentially be interested in any other features you have. So like, that's just to give you an idea of the scale. Like, you're going to make a lot more money generally if you have a breakout on a shooter than you are if you have a platform that breaks out.
Will, do you want to tell the story of, so we have a really good partner that we're working with right now. Started out super indie, and we can't tell you their name because we want to tell you the numbers. So, do you want to tell the story?
Just giving me my guidelines.
Yes.
So,
no
yeah.
Names.
So, we had a game developer come to us, and they had no art, but they had really great mechanics. And they, their CEO was previously like a big shot over at another gaming company, so we knew that he was good, and that's how he knew people to come talk to us. Their studio was pretty close to going under. They needed some additional funding. One of our heads played their game and was like, wow, this is really great. It's got tight mechanics. Everything looks good. No art or anything like that. So we gave them some funding, and they like took off. They were doing pretty well, and they started adding some art. It was looking really great. It was supposed to be an Xbox 360 game, and then we're coming up on the Xbox One release window, and we're like, oh, you know, maybe we should delay this game a little bit. To make the Xbox One window, they started coming to us saying, oh, you know, we're behind our development. We really want this game to be a really high Metacritic because it's our first game coming out of the studio. We've got a lot of industry vets here. We think it's going to be great. And so they ended up having to delay the game. The game wasn't ready. They really wanted to get this high Metacritic. And anytime you delay a game, generally, that means you need to add a lot more funding to fund all the people who have staffed up to that point in the production phase.
Can I interrupt really quick?
Yeah.
The key key there is that these guys wanted to make sure that the game that they were going to market, they don't care about sales. They didn't care about sales. They cared about the critical rating.
Yeah,
so,
exclusively about their Metacritic
yeah.
rating. That was their dream, was to have a 90 Metacritic rated game.
And they did.
Yep. And
now you can probably figure it out because there aren't that many 90 Metacritic rated games on Xbox One. But go on.
So we ended up delaying, and with that delay meant that we needed to move over to the Xbox One because we didn't want to release a whole bunch of new content on the Xbox 360, especially if this was going to be a 90 Metacritic rated game. But this game was targeted at a really niche genre, so it wasn't like we were doing it for revenue. We just wanted to have like some gem of a 90 Metacritic game on our new console. So we added up, and we ended up doubling their overall funding for the project that we had initially given them. So they had already invested their own money. These guys were very much, like, they'd spent quite a bit on this. And we were 2x what we thought we were going to be in for the game. And they released it, and it was great, and it was a wild success in terms of how much money we made off of it. But it was in a platformer genre, so it was hemmed in to, like, lifetime, maybe 20 million. Like, it's not like a breakout like we would have with a PUBG or one of those other ones where they sell 20 million copies. And it was an incredible success story.
The reason that I was able to tell the story is because these guys were super crystal clear about their goals. I'm going to repeat a formula that I mentioned earlier that I highly support. If you have a great idea, get it working and get it into one of the self-publishing platforms and engage with gamers that download your game. Ask them, set up a forum, ask them what they think. Link to the forum inside the game and go ask people what they think. And then take that, rework your game, and get it. Take it to the next level. Take next biggest self-publishing platform. I think this is an incredibly robust formula for incorporating the feedback of the people that you need to engage with to keep your game alive.
How much time do we have?
We are very short. 10 minutes.
Actually, we need the last 5 minutes for something else. So.
Okay.
Sorry about that.
I'm going to go ahead and skip the rest of those slides and very quickly go through some trends that you might want to take into account in the industry while you're thinking about your game. Number one, more and more games are moving themes. This doesn't affect your game design per se, but it affects your monetization plan. Subscriptions. EA started it with EA Access. Microsoft now has Game Pass. There's obviously PSN, Gamefly. What does your game look like, and what impact does being part of the subscription have on it? Will and I are going to confuse you because we're going to use the same word for two different things. Games, increasingly, Microsoft, Google, and other, and Bethesda have all announced that we are working on a cloud rendering game streaming to any device service. So what does that mean for your controls? If your game might be played on a mobile phone, as well as a PC, as well as a console, you would be correct in saying that the companies that are doing this streaming work should be the ones accountable for making the game playable no matter what the platform. But what would you do with that? Like, what would you do with that knowledge? Would you take advantage of the fact that somebody's on a mobile phone, and could you incorporate a geolocation element into your gameplay? Just something to think about. Broadcasting, also called streaming, is... Okay, it's super fast.
Okay, super fast. So broadcasting, it's growing really fast. It's great. If you look at growth in streaming, kind of split out some of the different platforms that we have. This is from one of the top streaming monetization sites. This is Streamlabs data. But you can see there's incredible growth, 40% year over year. This is basically becoming our new modern advertising. There's a big debate internally of whether streaming is a marketing expense or if it is some way to go and monetize and make a lot of money. There's companies now with esports that are making a lot. Blizzard this next year is supposed to be making, or they are on track right now, according to most industry estimates, to be at $1 billion in revenue. And a lot of that's one-time revenue for them selling Overwatch League franchises, but it's a lot of money. As far as most watched games in July, actually, I think we can probably just skip through a lot of this.
Yeah, why don't we? The one thing I would say about streaming is some games are just more fun to watch and easier to watch than others. Some games lend themselves to streaming, and skill-based games in particular are better for streaming. Because you can watch somebody play, you can learn from their play style, and maybe even get better yourself.
Yeah, so one other thing to note here. So now there's a lot of content deals that are going down. Blizzard has a 2-year exclusivity deal with Twitch, where they're only running their esports on Twitch. League of Legends just got signed by BAMTech. These guys are owned by the MLB, the same people who run the NHL, NBA, and all those. It's a $300 million deal for 7 years. It's incredible. So there's a lot of money that's now moving into this, and honestly, I think you're going to see a significant change in even what's on your TV going forward as these guys get a lot more advertisers. Overwatch League, let's get to that.
Yep. So you can't make your game an esport game. You do not have that ability. You can, however, put features in your game to make it easier for people that want to compete to play against other people. But it's up to your community to decide whether or not your game's skill level lends itself to esports level competition. I'm going to skip this one, the cross-platform play. Basically, this is about the idea that more and more services are defining different platforms, and so the hardware itself is less relevant. So, for instance, you can play Minecraft between PlayStation and you can now play Fortnite between PlayStation and Switch. And then funding sources. Do you guys care about funding sources? So it's not all publishers these days. There are other places to get money. Crowdfunding is incredibly successful and powerful. Pay-ahead betas, that's what PUBG was. They raised their money to make that game by charging people for the beta. And then outside of the U.S., government grants are plentiful and relatively easy to get. The last thing to keep in mind, if you're collecting data, if you're making a service-based game, you are creating a legal position for yourself. GDPR, anybody know what that is? Yeah, so it's a new piece of legislation that just got passed in Europe. For the EU, that governs, it places tremendous clamps on what you can do with data, on cookies. Have you noticed that all your websites are like, hey, by the way, we use cookies? That's GDPR and the anticipation of similar laws that are about to be passed here in California. And then finally, the DSM has declined for the 10th year in a row to classify gaming addiction as an illness, but the World Health Organization is recommending that we treat gaming addiction as a true illness. And how this affects game development is specifically loot boxes. Loot boxes are considered to be gambling, and in certain countries, in Belgium in particular, it is actually a felony to have a loot box in your game. So unless you want to go to jail in Belgium, or you never want to go to Belgium, be careful about distributing loot box as a means for so I think that's the last slide. And I think we have 5 minutes for more Q&A.
We can take maybe one question.
Okay. No questions? Okay. Well, you guys are awesome. Thank you for putting up with our lateness and sweatiness. And good luck with everybody. I hope to see your games. I can't wait to play them. So let me know when they're in the market.
Thank you. So for the big question, we're going to keep it simple. If you're in 146, tell me, why is your game going to stand out? I think the point that was hit on many times from different angles today was, hey, it's a crowded marketplace. Tell me, why is your game going to stand out? We'll explore some techniques on Thursday, but I want to know, I want to get us started on that track. If you're not in 146, tell me about a game that stood out to you. What made it different? What made you want to play that game? What set it apart from the crowd? If you're not on 146, we'll see you after the break. Have a great break. Otherwise, we'll see you on Thursday. Thank you.